Now, very recent signing. He hopes to do well here, but does have to deal with Amnesiak. And to be honest, during opening week, I'd have to give it to Amnesiak in terms of overall performance. Pavel had some amazing matches, but he also had a few shaky moments as well. He did get knocked into the lower bracket of his group pretty viciously, but just about managed to come back. But let's not think about anything else now, because we're going to get into the first game. Amnesiak on his Hunter versus Pavel on the Rogue.
So yeah, Pavel with the Rogue, and this is potentially a weak spot for his deck because, or for his lineup, sorry, because there is a lot of aggressive punishing tempo decks in Amnesiak's lineup that he's brought to this. He's made a few changes himself. He switched away from the Face Hunter to a slightly slower mid-range variant. As you can see, there's now Savannah High Mains packing in the deck, whereas he was all out damage during opening week. So that might give the Rogue a little bit more of a chance, but still, Hunter, extremely aggressive class, and beat up on these rogues very effectively.
Yeah, and the, you know, Amnesiak's Hunter list is something we've been discussing quite a lot, actually. There is the high main, but there is a single high main, and there are two Stranglethorn Tigers, yes, which versus Rogue, again, are exceptional. You can't sap a stealth target, and they are guaranteed damage almost all of the time. Gonna be a Cloaked Huntress coming out from Amnesiak. He did pick the cat trick from the tracking as well to get this kind of a power turn with double secrets, and Rogue plays a lot of spells, Sol, so this cat is going to be coming out to say hello pretty quickly.
Yeah, and straight away, Pavel to his rapid fire play, even with such a complex scenario as the two secrets in play. He knows what they are, first and foremost. There's only two secrets in Amnesiak's list, the freezing trap and the cat trick. So Pavel made this play, the backstab SI7 counter, with the knowledge full in his mind that the cat in the hat was going to come out here. But was he banking on a Huffer following it up?
Definitely not. Huffer from Animal Companion can be one of the most intense moments in the game here. Is this really just either can remove the SI7 agent, pressure for damage, the SI will get bounced by freezing if it's left up.
Yep.
And then, well, yeah, there's Tomb Pillager, but that just feels pretty slow when there's 8 power on board.
Yeah, Amnesiak just taking his time here, considering the implications of giving essentially another 5 mana removal tool to his opponent in his hand, but 5 mana SI7 agent, it still demands a combo tool to be used to go along with it. You saw a backstab paired with it on the previous turn. Preparation is obviously something that you have to worry about, but for me, this is 8 damage to the face, but Amnesiak actually bails out, decides to trade here.
Yeah, I think what he wants to do is know that he can go the long game. He does have the second tracking, so he can pick up some late game options, maybe a bow. And the idea is you expect Tomb Pillager on 4 from Rogue. And well, this is going to come down, and there's no other minions that can really, you know, that they're really cheap enough to be able to bounce. So if the Tomb Pillager gets bounced back with the freeze in, then it just slows the game down even more on Pavel's side, and Amnesiak can continue on with this pressure.
Raven, I have a counterpoint. If Tomb Pillager came down this turn and you'd just gone face and the SI7 had got frozen, you've dealt 16 damage in that period of time, even more with this Houndmaster follow-up. I personally would have gone aggressive in this line. Amnesiak definitely knows what he's doing. He's still in a very comfortable spot here. He's thinking, you can push that thought process one turn forward, and now he's saying, okay, this Tomb Pillager gets frozen. I push 6 this turn, and then next turn, essentially, I can push another 10 again. Hey, that's 16 too, so we could essentially just end up back in the same spot, so I can understand his line of thinking here, but we'll see if the just the slightly conservative play comes back to bite him in the later turns.
Yeah, I'm a fan of the smock option more than anyone, and you know, like you said, this from Amnesiak, sorry, maybe just lining up more damage in the future. The tracking is going to be pretty key, I think, to close out the game. One kill command is already gone, as that was one of Amnesiak's options from his initial tracking.
Right.
So there's only one more left, but there is still Eagle Horn Bow. There is still Quick Shot as well. So there's still plenty of damage you can draw into if he gets to the point where he needs it to close out the game. Pavel is going to clear up the board and just not attack with the Tomb Pillager. Wants to get something else down so he can maybe get the coin quicker.
Yeah, I think he wants that Tomb Pillager to die, particularly looking at his hand right now. He wants a combo activator for the SI7 agent. He wants a buff for the Edwin. The coin is an extremely good card for him right now. So he's trying to find a way to use this Tomb Pillager as a trading tool on the board or even as an aggressive pushing tool and still be able to get that coin as a follow-up. But Amnesiak's hand now just running a little bit dry, and this is where that tracking might come into play to give him some gas for a following turn, as you said. You can add Stranglethorn Tiger to that list of cards that you came up with as well. That'd be a huge pickup. His one high main, of course, was another card that was lost to the original tracking along with the kill command. So some of his late game options have been diminished.
Yeah, I think exactly to your point, I like this turn from Amnesiac. He uses all of his mana. He hasn't got Pavel down enough where a hero power every turn is going to count yet.
Yep.
And also next turn, he can track into a tiger and just play the tiger. So he'll be on 6 mana. So I really like this play. Just put as much annoyance on the board for Pavel to deal with and then build off that tracking next turn.
Speaking of annoyance, I think Pavel needs to create some this turn. If his plan is to be able to operate with this Tomb Pillager bypassing the freezing trap, he needs to get some minions on the board right now. And there's a pretty miserable looking turn that involves playing a 2-2 Edwin Van Cleef. But still, it's one of the best ways that he can set up a potential freeze on a minion that's not the Tomb Pillager.
Yeah, do you think there's ever a reason to go the other way and play the SI first?
Play the SI and then just have a 4-4 Edwin.
You don't need to kill these minions, right? They're annoying, but they're very low damage at the moment.
The less of the minions you kill, the more flexibility you give to your opponent in being able to deny that freezing trap counterplay that you're obviously trying to set up from Pavel's perspective. So I think this order is correct. That's a little bit of a punish for him because now the 1-1 can take care of the 2-1 and start limiting his options
if
on the board.
An Eagle Horn Bow comes out to clear the SI 7 agent, then this could get very, very frustrating. Pavel does use the weapon to proc the first part of the Grandmother, at least, and make that trade a little bit more awkward because suddenly the trade looks way better into the SI, but then the Van Cleef is bounced. And Van Cleef being bounced a lot of the time isn't too terrible.
Yeah, that weapon attack very much dictated by where the Fiery Batshot ended up going. And now Amnesiac with the Eagle Horn Bow pickup is going to go for it. This is a representation of a lot of damage. Also, just a great board control tool here. And that Tomb Pillager, this game of chicken with the Freezing Trap that has gone on since turn 3 when it was put into play with the Cloaked Huntress, just continues. And the stalemate right now is favoring the Hunter because he's trotting hero power by hero power towards victory.
Yeah, and the frustration now is Pavel had multiple options or multiple turns to actually prot the freezing trap, and now he needs to prot the traps and there's a bow equipped.
Yep.
And in Pavel's list, there is no weapon destruction, so this bow is only going to get more and more charges. And as you mentioned, you can't exactly just not prop the traps for a while and try and make the Hunter trade. You'll just press hero power every turn and you will die.
Yeah, the bow is so miserable here because if there was a low pressure turn from Amnesiac from Pavel's perspective, he could have just frozen Tomb Pillager, replayed Tomb Pillager if he was allowed the time to do that for 6 mana. But not wanting to give the extra bow charges, as you said, he's just going to play out Auctioneer here, try and have it operate as a 4-4 taunt.
Yeah, and Amnesiac's got a really weird game plan here because both of the kill commands are actually gone through tracking. Obviously, Pavel won't know that, so it's something he's going to be very, very conscious of. But Amnesiac has to sort of piece together the puzzle without that huge burst damage, because a lot of the time it's how Hunter just ends the game. Especially when you have tigers around that you can just guarantee the proc because they're just not going to be killed while they're in stealth. So we'll see how Amnesiac decides to start to put that together, because Pavel knows now there is no burn in hand because there are no cards in hand.
Yeah, and this now is Pavel's moment. He has to figure out his way through this turn. Now, there are, again, 2 secrets equipped right now, so he knows there is a cat trick up. He knows the cat trick is going to proc right now, so he would have loved perhaps a Blood Mage pick up there to be able to fan off the cat trick from the board, but now he's going to go through his turn. I'm sure the Fan of Knives will end up getting cycled here. He can freeze the Tomb Pillager, attack into the Infested Wolf with the Gadgetzan Auctioneer, and then use Fan of Knives to clear off that, but he needs a really powerful chain of draws here.
Sinister Strike is not here.
Sinister Strike is a cycle, and it still opens up that card. The second Fan of Knives. That is exactly what he needed in this spot. The Sinister Strike could be played, but now picks up the Swashburglar as well. Allows him to keep the Malagos Sinister Strike and a giant sandworm just to round it off.
Why not?
What else could you need?
Probably nothing at this point. So Pavel had an amazing turn there. Killing the Cat in the Hat is so important.
Yep.
It does so much damage. Obviously, the stealth makes that very difficult, but Fan of Knives into Fan of Knives is huge there. And suddenly, Amnesiac, with just an Infested Wolf in hand, he's got a lot of bow charges, but is it going to be enough when you know your opponent's got a hell of a lot of card advantage on you right now?
Yeah, we talked about the game of chicken that Pavel was playing with the Freezing Trap. Catrick in most matchups is a game of chicken. In the Warrior matchup, you try and bring it out and then Brawl in the same turn. In the Shaman matchup, you try and bring it out, Spell Power, Maelstrom Portal in the same turn. Pavel found that spot where he could cycle, get some AoE options. The double Fan of Knives pulled it together, and now he's just about finding a way to climb back into this game. But Amnesiac, with an empty hand and a dream, is pushing through the damage he needs. I do wonder again whether that slightly less aggressive line that he took early on in the game might just come back to bite him, because remember, as you pointed out, both kill commands out of the deck at this point, so his finishing reach is a little bit lackluster.
Yeah, the options he realistically has are chaining quit shots, just to be able to stack up that damage extremely quickly. He would pretty much need to draw Tiger now, or the last one I was going to talk about is Rakdos!
Oh, baby!
That is one of the very few cards in the deck that could pull him back into this, especially because what I like to refer to as a Yolagos has been played. You just put it on the board, hope that it doesn't die.
I mean, this is definitely the setup for Pavel, because
yeah, there's the game.
There's one deadly shot in the list from Amnesiac, which is really the only card that's going to interact with this. If it doesn't, it sets up lethal. This Ragnaros outcome here can potentially just decide this entire game. This is a huge rag.
Yeah, Amnesiac has the ability to just go for a 1-in-3 here to be able to finish this game. And you know what? Not knowing what you're going to draw next and no resources in hand to do anything with them anyway, I wouldn't even blame him at this point.
Yeah, Amnesiac just considering his options here, whether he wants to try and set up the more likely kill on the Malagos to try and extend the game longer, because he has Rag on the board right now. So he can set up a situation where the bad outcome of hitting Malagos kills Malik. He turns it down. He says no. He says 1-in-3. I will take my 33%. And Ragnaros says yes.
That.
Yes, son.
Woo. Amnesiac with the plays. He took a risk to end the game right there. He had no more resources left, and you know what? That was enough to put him ahead in this series.
Yeah, absolutely huge outcome for him. Pavel took the risk of his own, just dropping the Malagos on the board, could set that up for the lethal on the backswing the following turn. Amnesiac read his outs, set up his 33%, huge first game win for him.
Yeah, a truly explosive ending to that first game. And don't go anywhere, because we will be back soon to continue this series.
Hearthstone World Championship is sponsored in part by Intel, T-Mobile, NVIDIA, and Republic of Gamers.
Walk up on the stage to play your first match against Yolsick. Are you going to be nervous?
Probably not. I think I'm going to win. Young Savage doesn't lose.
One problem that I see with you playing at BlizzCon is that your name is really hard to chant.
You know what has less syllables, DJ?
If you walk out on stage and everybody's chanting your name, are you going to be nervous?
Young Savage doesn't get nervous.
There's been a lot of hype around you over the course of the year. A lot of players, as they've seen new players qualify, they'll still say, you know, I think Amnesiac's probably, you know, one of the favorites to win the whole thing. How do you feel about that?
I think it's cool. I mean, I don't disagree with them, honestly. I definitely feel like I'm one of the strongest players at this tournament. I'm not just looking to make it out of groups or make it to semis. I'm definitely looking to win the whole thing.
you make it out of groups and you play in front of, you know, thousands of people. Does that make you nervous?
That just sounds cool.
Yeah, it is pretty cool. What if you're playing against me on the big stage at BlizzCon?
I don't think I get free wins at BlizzCon, TJ. Usually go by Amnesiac. Sometimes I go by Young Savage. When the goings get tough, I'm Captain America.
Casting at this stage is cool, so I have no doubt playing is an Amnesiac, super confident, and so far that is paying off. 1-0 up versus Pavel.
Yeah, I mean, Amnesiac has been one of the breakouts of this whole procedure, this year-long process of getting to this point now of crowning a world champion. He has what I'd like to call the Goldilocks of confidence. His confidence is just right. It's not too much, it's not too little. He knows how good he is. He's not afraid to say it. He's not afraid to put pressure on himself with some of his statements because he knows he has the mentality to live up for it. And his first game performance there just backed all of that up. It's Pavel now on the back foot trying to fight back from behind.
Yeah, but we did see Pavel in opening week fight from behind. He reverse killed to book his spot here. So it's definitely a situation he's been in. It is only the first game. This is a best of seven, so plenty more to come yet. And we are moving on to a Tempo Mage mirror match.
It is. It's a mirror match in terms of archetypes, but these two lists are about as different as Tempo Mage can get. They're both staying short of the Cabalist Tome, you know, Yogg-Saron, etc. package, but Amnesiac's very cycle-heavy, very burn-heavy, the Forgotten Torch that you can see in hand. Pavel has the extra minions all the way through the curve. He has babbling books that Amnesiac doesn't have. He has faceless summoners. He has water elemental. Minions all the way up, curving out to rag. So the way this matchup might play out is just Pavel playing minions, Amnesiac trying to control the board, set up a burn victory later in the game after he's run Pavel out of steam, but very often, this matchup, despite being between two reasonably aggressive decks, actually kind of passive from both sides, where they both hoard cards in their hand and look for a swing turn.
Yeah, and you know, one of the key cards for that swing turn is the Flame Waker, and looks like Pavel's gonna just say, okay, I'm just gonna play mine on curve. If you don't kill it, then I'm gonna run away with this game with just at least coin. He has Arcane Blast, can combine it with Thanos, or just Frost Nova as well, depending on what comes out. But Amnesiac, of course, does have the answer. A pretty clean answer as well.
Yeah. And but this strategy makes sense to me from Pavel because, like I said, he has the deck that's more likely to hit a minion curve. Yeah. He does play minions all the way through, so he can just keep pressure up, start playing a minion on each turn, then he can find himself in a reasonably comfortable spot just developing onto the board. But right now, he's just hit a little interruption point and developing the Drake into this Cult Sorcerer cannot feel good, and Amnesiac is chilling on the perfect answer in the Arcane Blast that he deliberately reserved, choosing to use the more expensive Frostbolt on the previous turn.
Yeah, he has a lot of options now as well. He's going to go for the Acolyte of Pain to get the minion on the board now to start to build up to the cycle and basically pester Pavel to have to deal with it versus the Arcane Intellect, which is more initial, instant card draw. We'll see if Pavel can actually deal with it. He didn't really have anything too great at the moment. He can clear it off with the Cult Sorcerer or the Thanos and an Arcane Blast, but he needs to be able to clear the, you know, Amnesiac's Cult Sorcerer as well, because they're just going to counter each other out, and Amnesiac will gain the initiative initially.
Yeah, I like this a lot more, just going for the Arcane Missiles play. That Acolyte was a huge annoyance for him. That Arcane Missiles draw could have been potentially huge. Had to take care of the Acolyte first, and ooh!
He got
the
it.
Missiles, the tease!
Yeah.
They tried to bait us into thinking they were going phase. The last two got the job done, and this is kind of the matchup in a nutshell. It's just swings on the board back and forth, especially the way the late game cards line up. You'll see a Firelands Portal come down, and then a Firelands Portal hit the Firelands Portal minion, and then they'll rag the Firelands Portal minion, and then they'll rag the rag, and it just goes back and forth like that. One of the swingiest mirrors in the game for sure.
100%. Amnesiac does not have an amazing turn for now. Does have the Arcane Intellect to fish for some options. I think he needs to. Just fireballing face normally isn't the play. And using Arcane Missiles of his own, he does have the Mage Hero Power to be able to clear up as long as one hits. And one does. So as you said, it's going to be you play a minion or remove it. Then I play a minion, then you remove it.
Yeah, I mean, but this...
A true gentleman's game.
This Blood Mage Thaunos is about as miserable as it can get as a target for a Firelands pull, but unless he picks up something rather appealing... Okay, I mean, that could change his mind here. He didn't really have any gas to play this turn, so it looked like it was just going to have to be a Firelands pull for board dominance. Picking up the Barnes now is just really nice for him, because now he gets to weave that in with the ping and just keep a board position here. And now... You want to be the last guy acting in this matchup. When I described that chain of events of Firelands Pool hitting Firelands Pool, etc., you want to be the guy going second in all of those scenarios. So Amnesiac is taking this turn to just sit back and let Pavel initiate the chain of power cards.
Yeah, and we see the mirror image get played there. Kind of looks a bit funky, but his next turn is going to be Ragnaros. That is the Firelands Pool, and that is a horrible draw from it, the Buzzard. I miss you, friend, from when you were not nerfed.
This is incredible.
The 3-2 is huge.
That is the second Firelands Portal Starving Buzzard that Amnesiac has had against him in this tournament. That's insane.
He controls the portals.
He does. Young Savage knows what's up, apparently.
The Ragnaros was chosen over the portal purely because the Buzzard is just not enough of a threat to want the guaranteed kill. It's going to be a Flame Waker response from Pavel, though. He does have Frost Nova as a backup. All the Fireball if any of the pings hit the Rag, and they don't. It's going to have to be a Frost Nova.
Yeah, even if the pings go perfectly here, the Dragon's Breath is still not castable, so... Ragnaros does not give one single damn about being frozen right now. The Frost Nova just helped him to clear out. And that Firelands portal that he held onto, I mean...
Look at the difference.
I mean...
A Buzzard versus a Berserker.
Yeah. America just has better portals, apparently. It's just a fact.
And this is what we were talking about earlier. Amnesiac now took that one extra step in being able to not have his board responded to. And on top of that, he dealt with Pavel. And now this Water ML is going to come down, but is it going to be enough? More than likely, no, as there is a Fireball and a Roaring Torch available for Amnesiac. And hey, why not? Another Firelands Portal as well.
That is just, as they say in the business, lethal. And Amnesiac is going to jam through the damage. 2-0 in dominant fashion. Definitely got the run of the cards in that matchup, but played it well, understood the pattern and the pacing of the matchup, put himself in the comfortable position, and now, speaking of comfortable positions, 2-0, nerve settled, in the zone. Young Savage is looking on point right now.
Yeah, he is definitely looking great. Pavel is still in this series, though. We'll find out if he can mount a comeback right after this.
Do you think you have a playstyle?
In Hearthstone, it's not about playstyle. It's about which play have better chances to give you a win.
What about if you don't know which play is better?
I will choose play which I feel give me more chance to win.
How did you prepare for the World Championship?
Just thinking about which decks is the best. Test it on ladder and with my practice partners.
Like, who were your main practice partners?
I don't have main practice partners, but I was practice with Jok, Maverick, it's French players. Also, with Naiman and Hippie, we had Skype call.
What's the Russian Hearthstone scene like?
Russian community have a lot of strong players. For example, Штанудачи, Унви, Калента, Нейман.
Who would you want to beat the most?
Doesn't matter too much.
Not Dr. Hippie?
Yeah, it will be nice to beat Dr. Hippie. This little troll.
Pavel wants to beat Dr. Hippie. He's going to have to go through Amnesiac first, and it's looking like it's not going well for him, being 0-2 down against the Young Savage. And this is just, you know, it's looking so good for Amnesiac here.
It is, he's in a great spot, and it could possibly come down to this ban strategy that we haven't really talked about. Both shamans being banned out here, which surprised me a little bit, and Amnesiac echoed my surprise when he found out which of his decks was being banned. He was amazed that his shaman was being banned. Yeah, his words were, that isn't even the second best ban. So he thinks Pavel's made a potential misstep here in which deck that he's getting rid of. So.
Yeah, we'll see if that plays out. I mean, he does have a few good matchups, but I guess, you know, one of the true fears is that Shaman can just win any single game.
Sure.
You know, the class is so strong at the moment that he's got such great matchups across the board. But yeah, you know, Amnesiac was kind of surprised. So even going into the series before game one started, he was feeling comfortable. We are going to game three now. Amnesiac rocking with the Zoo and Pavel on his Rogue.
Amnesiac here deciding to hold on to Voidwalker Knife Juggler. And this is a nuance to Zoo that, you know, some people don't pick up on until they're hundreds of games into the deck, where people will just keep an opening curve. But you need to decide, especially when you play the as many one-drops are as in the list as these days, you can very much mulligan for specific one-drops that you want, not just keeping a pure curve. So this keep from Amnesiac is a deliberate statement that he wants the Voidwalker in his opening. And this addition to the deck, the Swashburglar, might just have a big part in that.
Yeah, even having, like, you know, two Swashburglers make it even more, well, twice as likely to draw into them anyway. And, you know, a bit of an early game, something we saw out from Handsome Guy sort of really started going with the more early game in the road to start keeping up with the early tempo plays from some other classes. But Amnesiac is just going to follow up with his Dark Peddler. But the Possessed Villager seems pretty good to me.
It does, yeah, but this hand from Pavel is just coming together beautifully. He has Backstab SI, he has the coin, he has a variety of combo activators with the other one mana Swashburglar in his hand right now. This is always a concern for you as the Zoo deck, you know, having an SI target on the board when Rogue gets the coin in the matchup. Amnesiac didn't have any way to play around it. He played the weaker threat out of the 2/2s and the Dark Peddler, accounting for this exact scenario. But now the abusive Sergeant might have just bailed him out of trouble at least for one turn.
Yeah, Pavel choosing not to use the backstab and clear up the whole board there against the Zoo, but it's going to be enough. Abusive Sergeant does help the Voidwalker clear up, and this is looking pretty good now for Amnesiac. The double Possessed Villager with a follow-up of double a Knife Juggler if required to do the trade and get them juggles going.
Sacrificial Pact picked up from the Swashburglar. Will we see that have an impact later on?
It's a pretty good way to kill a Doomguard, I've heard.
Tell me more. Knife Juggler number 2 comes down. There is a lot of knives to be thrown out here, but he's just going to trade it out. The aggression is ramping up, and now Pavel's decision to hold back on the backstab is looking a lot more promising. He knows there are high priority targets to take care of in this deck with the backstab, so he are now able to at least deal with one of these Knife Jugglers. But despite the coin SI start from Pavel, Amnesiac has fought his way back onto this board, and that abusive Sergeant pickup was absolutely key to being able to maintain his board dominance.
Yeah, the SI7 agent would have just ran rampant if that was not the case. But what's interesting to me here is Pavel has a Pit Lord, not something you really want to be able to play versus a Zoo deck, which is very aggressive. And Rogue kind of struggles with its life total in general. There's not many running heals anymore. Soulfire being used to clear up some of the board. I imagine we're going to see a trade. Fan of Knives would absolutely destroy Amnesiac at the moment.
Yeah, but Amnesiac, one of the best players I've ever seen at reading opposing hands in this situation. So he will just be going through his mind right now, logging every read he has on every card in his opponent's hand, and just trying to figure out whether he can be aggressive in this spot. I think 99.9% of the time, that trade would always happen. But I think this is perhaps Perhaps a key difference between him and Pavel is that Pavel has a little bit of a tendency to snap play in that situation, whereas maybe Amnesiac is using that extra time just to squeeze out a better play, and it's good to see decision-making get rewarded, right?
Yeah, it seemed to work out pretty well for Amnesiac, as Phantom Knives was the card drawn, and now Pavel is in a rough situation. He can just play the Azure Drake, but he knows pretty much just dies, as well as more development from Amnesiac the following turn. He's gonna go for the Fan of Knives into no doubt the Hero Power. The prep being drawn the wrong way around to a certain extent, which is a little bit further ahead. If he could get Azure Drake prep and Fan of Knives off, that would have been so much better for them. But he does just leave the Direwolf on the board now.
Yeah, but it does mean now that Pavel has Auctioneer and a prep in his hand that he does need to cycle through his deck quickly, pick up some power cards, get the damage through, because if Pavel is allowed time here, he can start to get a grip back on proceedings. But with only the prep in his hand right now, along with that Sacrificial Pact, which is not looking too promising, he doesn't have too high potential.
Amnesiac's been playing around it very well.
He's played around Sacrificial Pact perfectly by not drawing any demons.
Yeah. But this draw is going to be a point, a second Silverware Golem. Zero reason not to tap here. Even if you get the Doom Guard, that Silverware Golem is going to hit the board. Gets the Peddler instead. Ooh, another Abusive.
Abusive is just damage in this situation. It's a straight-up flip between whether he wants to take the Abusive and push damage right now, also limits his board development, because of course he can't play the Golem as well on top of that, or whether he wants a more resilient minion in the form of the Voidwalker. But it looks like he is going to take the Abusive, but now the secondary branch on the tree, he's actually just going to go for maximum board presence right now, hold the Abusive back for some follow-up damage.
Yeah, I think after seeing the Fan of Knives as well, you're feeling, you know, pretty confident that there just won't be a follow-up one. You can get the minions down now, and there almost certainly will be a minion for the Abusive Sergeant to buff next turn. And this is just setting up lethal for Amnesiac. Pavel has to do some work some wonders here to stabilize in this game now.
Yeah, and there is still damage to come, and despite you pointing out Sacrificial Pact, beautiful answer to a Doomguard, doesn't do much good if they just rip that Doomguard, hit you in the face with it, and you are dead.
Yeah, unfortunately, you can't play cards after the game has ended. You can't recover health once you've hit zero. But even not seeing any Gang Boss or anything like that, which, you know, Sac Pack would be even, you know, really great against. So this has not been working out for Pavel. His Swashburglar is not getting the cards he needed. There is going to be 5 power left on the board. 2 more from the Abusive Sergeant. There are many draws left for Amnesia that could just win this game outright. Double Abusive Sergeant.
There's a
Doom Guard as well. Fist pump from Amnesiac. And this is shaping up to be a very fast set indeed, as he makes this 3-0 so far versus Pavel.
Everything is coming together right now for Amnesiac. He is playing extremely well. Take nothing away from that, but he is getting the run of the cards in some situations as well. It's almost as if his young savage just written on that trophy already.
I mean, he's just having the games of his life at the moment. Is Amnesiac gonna make it 4-0? We are gonna find out very soon.
Championship is sponsored in part by Intel, T-Mobile, NVIDIA, and Republic of Gamers.
Do you feel a lot of pressure having practiced with some of these, you know, bigger names in the Americas region?
I don't know if I feel pressure so much as like pride. It's almost like I'm carrying the torch. Like a lot of my friends worked really hard this year, like Nostum, Chalky, Frozen, like Muzzy. I had a lot of respect for how hard they worked and how much they improved throughout a year. So I feel like almost a sense of like NA pride, like I'm kind of carrying the torch for the grinders.
How important is prepping a lot? And do you think you're on another level than other players as far as, you know, your practice regimen goes?
I think I definitely worked the hardest, or maybe not the hardest, but I think I worked in some balance of the hardest and the most efficiently and the best in preparation for this tournament. I think there's a big misconception about hard work. I don't think it means just grinding away all day, every day, like mindlessly. I think hard work has less to do with grinding and more to do with having a strong mental state and making sure you're on focus.
Do you have any potential plans for the money, parents permitting? But you could go to school four times with $250,000.
Yeah, depending on where you go, for sure.
Would you go to college four times?
No, TJ.
You could be in college till you're 32.
Like how old you are?
I'm 26.
This could be the final game for Amnesiac in this set. And there is a chicken in the tavern. Angry chicken, I hope. But Pavel has been in this situation in opening week. He has been 0-3 down, and he fought all the way back to a 4-3 victory. It is doable, and he has to have that in mind going into this next game, Sol.
Yeah, it was one of the best sets of opening week, honestly. It had everything. It had, you know, great play. It had the absolute emotional roller coaster of the comeback. It had absolute Yogg-Saron nonsense towards the end of the series as well. And Pavel is going to need much of the same to get back into this series, because Amnesiac is just chilling on Malagos Druid now. And that's one of the, if not the most powerful decks in the format, and it's all Amnesiac has left to win with.
Yeah, and we're going to get right into it. Pavel has chosen to go with his C'Thun Warrior to battle and potentially get his first point on the board versus Amnesiac's Druid. And this can be a really sort of wonky matchup to a large extent. A lot of the time, C'Thun Warrior can actually just beat up its opponents with the, you know, if it plays the minions on curve. We can see now that there's Disciple of C'Thun, there's C'Thun's Chosen straight into Emperor Leia and the Ancient Shield Bearer. So a lot of the power Pavel has now, and you don't really need the War Axes too early versus Druid. They don't normally hammer out the threats straight off the bat. So Pavel looking okay, but Amnesiac, double Wild Growth. Not terrible either.
Both of these players just have fantastic hands in this situation. This is what I want to see in a potential decider matchup, is both players drawing well and two heavy hitting decks going up against each other. But this matchup, one of my favorite to watch, one of my favorite to play as well, because both players have to be so adaptable to situations. The C'Thun Warrior over a regular Control Warrior, because of the additional life gain that it has in the deck, is even less vulnerable to the pure Malagos burst combo that the Druid can sometimes still manage to force through against just a pure Control Warrior, which means most of the time the Druid has to go for board presence, go for minions, try and get as much value as they can, and just keep up pressure with minion presence, try and finish with your Arcane Giants and your Rag after you've overloaded the Warrior's removal. But it does very much come down to reading the situation correctly and adapting your game plan turn by turn. And decisions like, what do I take off Raven Idol, were just a huge part of that.
Yeah, I was just about to say, I'm really interested to see what Amnesiac does with this Raven Idol going forward. And we're about to find out. Looks like it could well be a spell to help deal with this C'Thun's Chosen, because he's ahead in mana, but he simply just cannot play as Yordrake into a C'Thun's Chosen. And
right.
Pavel will be very happy if that happens. Amnesiac trying to get another option and bite, although would kill it off, except for that pesky Divine Shield. It's so awkward to deal with. No Moonfires available for Amnesiac to help him out there. And this is kind of a tough pick for him.
It is, and this just kind of explains the situation I was talking about perfectly, where you will hear a lot of high-level players say you are always supposed to take minion in this matchup from Raven Idol. I've heard people that Amnesiac practices with, part of that practice group that he was talking about in the media piece, I've heard them say very similar things, but Amnesiac just recognizing, look at the state of the game right now. I have two Arcane Giants in my hand. That makes me want a spell. There's an annoying 4-2 minion on the board that I can't deal with. That makes me want a spell. So he's being adaptable to the state
of the matchup, tries to pick up an answer. Bite less than ideal, but it's at least something.
Yeah. Interesting playing from Pavel there. He could have just played a Disciple of C'Thun to get him up to that magical 10-10 C'Thun that unlocks cards like Ancient Shieldbearer and Twin Emperors. Chose not to and just armor up instead. I don't know if I would have liked to see that, but just one of them. You have two, and it piles on a little bit of pressure. You're a little bit vulnerable to Swipe, but if Swipe comes down this turn from Amnesia, then there's only three mana for him to play around with, and then you just build straight into the rest of your curve as well. So
I think what Pavel's doing here is just being stingy with his removal right now, because he doesn't have any in hand. He doesn't have a Shield Slam, he doesn't have an Execute, so he wants to make sure that those Disciple of C'Thuns can be used as removal tools, such as in this exact situation. Have the spare one to back this up now as well, because if big, intimidating minions hit the board, Emperors, Arcane Giants, all that kind of stuff, he needs to make sure he has game against that.
Yeah, and now Pavel's got choices of his six drops next turn as well, whether he values this hand high enough to drop the Emperor and get the reduction now, whether he just wants to drop Sylvanas, and it looks like Sylvanas is the option with Amnesiac just slamming that Arcane Giant down. Amnesiac having the opposite problem from Pavel of just having not enough options here.
And again, just look at the snap decision from Pavel. I don't know whether he spends a lot of time thinking about options during his opponent's turn, possibly, and has already planned a contingency for every scenario that could come down to him, but he had options that turn. Sure, I agree Sylvanas is probably the strongest, but it at least
warrants
a moment's thought. Pavel just refuses to slow down the pace here. Amnesiac now has to respect the Sylvanas, generates the extra minion token to try and reduce the chances, and he picks up the best outcome.
What is the follow-up? The hero power into the Disciple would just be a very, very straightforward, easy clear. Could even Feral Rage, but on 22, you're not gaining too much from the health at all at this point in the game. You might be able to combo it with a Fandral later for a much more impactful turn. So I like this. I don't think there's any point using the Innervate either, as Sylvanas or the Giant are more than likely playable next turn.
Yeah, I think any more commitment to this board and you start getting into dangerous Brawl territory, and that's one of the things when you've decided that you're going for the minion presence board aggression strategy, that's one of the things you have to be scared of, because your goal is to overload the warrior removal, have one or two more threats than they have Shield Slams and Executes and Slams and Bashes. So if you can do that, then part of that comes down to not giving your opponent too much value for a Brawl, which is why Amnesiac chose to hold back in that situation.
Yep, and now the Ancient Shieldbearer, fantastic for Pavel. Gaining the extra health, as you said earlier, trying to push yourself out of any potential Druid burst range, but simply with the lack of card draw that Amnesiac's been able to get hold of this game, Pavel's probably feeling pretty safe at this moment in time.
Yeah, he's running dry. He hit that Drake, that was his one card draw effect. Didn't pick up a Nourish or anything like that off the Raven Idol, so he is just running a little bit loose right now. He does have a couple of big threats in his hand, but nothing that can really swing the board state enormously. Double Feral Rage would discount his Arcane Giant by two. That would be a total 11 mana turn, so it is possible if he wants to swing the board in that way, but that basically is his all-in push, so I'm not surprised just to see him hold back.
Yeah, and the frustration as well is if you go for the Giant just as your main push here, with Pavel being on so much armor, then you just open yourself up to just Shield Slam.
Sure.
Done. And yep. Then, great, the warrior didn't even have to work for that. They already had the armor available. They just use a single one mana spell, clear up the Giant, and then suddenly it's looking even more grim for Amnesiac. Pavel in a fantastic position at the moment.
He is, yeah. Now he's starting to pick up those crucial spells, the Shield Slam and the Execute that we talked about him lacking earlier on. So now this hand pretty much just has everything.
Pavel can choose to just trade in the Shield Bearer, use the Disciple of C'Thun, equip the War Axe and clear up and be very clean. Could have gone for the crazy play and just gone face, but that wouldn't have worked out too well with a Sylvanas on the board, and you sort of give Amnesiac the options to make that work out for him, but it's going to be pretty straightforward, Pavel. Playing it safe.
Yeah, and you can see here the importance of both of those Disciples of C'Thun being ended up back in the hand, right? He's used each of them to solve a very tricky situation, one to take care of the Drake that was threatening to snowball against him, and one to clean up that Sylvanas board. So his decision just to hold back on that front has been a rewarding one for him. Amnesiac now does pick up some cycle with the Wrath, but he's going to need a serious amount of gas, and that is indeed it.
Yeah. Nourish for Cards can be super important for Amnesiac here. Will allow him to potentially get back in this game as he's not dead yet.
I mean, imagine we're going to see the Nourish use this turn as a bare minimum. Then we're going to see what the rest of the turn is. As you talked about the previous turn, the Arcane Giant is still vulnerable to Shield Slam. But now he has the Bomb Chain available to him here. And now I think we're going to see him Feral Rage the face and then innovate the Arcane Giant.
This plays
around Shield Slam. It requires an additional answer from Pavel, but Pavel has additional answers for days right now.
Yeah, but also, as you said, you know, because of the threat of the direct answer to the Giant and Amnesiac not having a backup plan, now he does. He just drops Rag and, you know, removes the armor unless a minion's played, you know, so he peels most of the armor off with the Rag. And then he has Maligos with at least Living Roots for now and potential draws later in the game. And, you know, Amnesiac, there you go. No thinking. It's going to be a Rag hero power. And there's no questions where this one's going to go, Sol.
There is not only one available target. It's going to cleave off that armor. But Pavel is drawing really nicely himself now in this game, picking up the Shield Bearer and the Shield Slam number two to be able to answer this Ragnaros. And I talked about the dynamic between the Druid Bomb Chain and the Warrior's removal. And it looks like Amnesiac's hand might just run dry before Pavel runs out of removal here, which will just leave him floundering against this late game power of the C'Thun Warrior deck.
Yeah, Pavel's draws have definitely lined up extremely well to deal with the threats as and when they come out. Amnesiac still has a couple of chances left. Does run Geddon in his list as well, so there is at least another threat that can put out a high amount of damage if it lives, but Pavel's actually just got removal for days at the moment. The Gore Howl, even just Gore Howl and the Geddon, if your health's relatively safe, that's still fine.
Yeah, chooses not to swing with the War Axe here. Isn't 100% sure he's going to be committing the Gore Howl next turn. Might want to use that War Axe as his activator for the Execute. Amnesiac here with little choice but to go for the Maligos. He's seen a lot of removal used already, but unfortunately for the young Savage, the Execute is it here, and it looks very much like Pavel is climbing his way back into this series one game at a time.
Yeah, even see it from the body language from Pavel. When he saw the Maligos go down and just the removal, he sat back up in his chair and was like, right, okay, pretty confident with this game. Once I get this game, I've got a good chance going forward.
So the Wrath gets cycled here from Amnesiac. Picks up Drake, so this isn't going too badly for him here, but so much of his late game has already gone that he's going to struggle to build enough initiative here that basically not only does he have to race the defensive line of tank up, he also has to race the real clock of C'Thun just being drawn, blowing out his board, perhaps just even straight up lethal. So he doesn't have time to mess around here, and with so many of his high value threats already gone, I think he's just going to fall flat of the mark. Right here.
Yeah, this is going to be rough. Amnesiac is not going to be able to realistically keep up with this. C'Thun's Chosen are going to continue to pound the pressure. And as he said, there's a 14-14 C'Thun, and Amnesiac's on 14 health. So this is looking pretty rough if the C'Thun comes into hand in the next turn or so. Amnesiac, second Moonfire with Maligos gone. It's just not really going to be enough. It doesn't want him to swipe and clear up the board with the two Moonfires as well. But that's pretty much everything he has.
I mean, he has to. He's just staring at lethal on board right now, so he has to have a reactive turn here, but all of these spells being used, and importantly, something that we haven't really talked about, Amnesiac's list does not play Yogg, so that is not a win condition. These Moonfires are not loading up the Yogg-Saron for him, so he is really just on a wing and a prayer right now and trying to find a way out of this matchup alive.
Yeah, didn't even play Emperor, as you know, it would be cleared up quite easily by Pavel's Gore Howl. There's just not a lot he can do. Acolyte is only going to be a further pain to seeing a Wrath a little bit earlier used to clear it open. This is looking very, very rough for Amnesiac right now. Even just looks like he doesn't even want to play the Maya Keeper. Yeah, the Maya Keeper, because if he plays it for ramp, then he gains nothing. If he plays it for the minion, then the Acolyte guarantees two draws. Justicar is going to hit the board now for Pavel. The tank up begins.
Welcome to the grand tournament indeed. And Amnesiac going to throw out the well played. Inky acknowledges that he is not beating Justicar this game. He gives it up. Pavel is on the board. Europe is on the road to recovery, Raven. But Pavel still has a very, very long way to go against, as I said, perhaps just the strongest deck in the game in Maligos Druid.
Yeah, that is only game one. And we will be coming back with Pavel's potential second victory coming up if he can beat out Amnesiac.
Your strategy with your decks coming into the World Championship?
I just bring decks which is, in my opinion, the best. I mean, all my decks is good against Control Warrior, maybe except Druid, but Druid also have decent chance against it. And all my decks in general very strong.
So how do you think you compare to the other players at the World Championship?
I don't think that anyone have better chance to win BlizzCon than me. Players have less chance than me, I think, and someone have equal chance.
Do you think winning BlizzCon will change your life?
Yeah, it will definitely change my life. I mean, I will get a lot of money, more popularity.
You were very close to qualifying for the World Championship last year.
Yep.
How did it feel this year after you won the last call and qualified?
Yeah, I'm super glad that I qualified for BlizzCon and that I'm here. Hopefully, I will win BlizzCon.
Pavel does have a mountain to climb. That mountain's name is Amnesiac. He's 1-3 down. And a lot of work to do for him. But he's, as we said earlier, he's been in this situation before, and before he gives it a go, he has just had to nip to the bathroom. How do you think this series is going to go for Pavelsov?
I mean, obviously, Amnesiac is in an incredibly favorable position. He has one of the best decks in the game available to him. Even if he was sat in a position where all of the matchups were cripplingly unfavored, you still have a good stab at winning one out of three of them. But the matchups that he's going to come up against are the Tempo Mage, Pavel's own Malagos Druid, which is a little bit different, a little bit more mid-rangey with the Dark Arrow Koas in there, as well as extra earlier minions than the Ancient of Wars and Rags that we're used to seeing. And of course, that Malagos Rogue that we've also seen already. So none of those are unwinnable matchups for Pavel. So he has to partition this. He has to approach it one game at a time. But purely statistically, of course, Amnesiac has a crushing, colossal edge right now. Like Mount Amnesiac is going to be a tough one to climb.
Yeah, and he's been playing so well, you know. We've got to try and be the biased ones for Europe, I guess, since we have Admirable and such, who's very much for these guys. But, you know, it's going to be very difficult. Amnesiac has simply been playing phenomenally so far. This looks like it could just be his tournament based on what he's done at the moment. But he does still have to get a game with that Druid. But as he said, it's just one of the powerful decks at the moment.
I don't think I have it in me to be as biased as Admirable. I don't think that's possible.
Yeah, he was definitely giving the cheers pretty heavy. And when I asked him about his prediction, I just shouldn't have even bothered. It's like, I wonder who you are predicting, Admirable. It's like, I already know.
I wish I was as passionate about anything as Admirable is about America.
Yeah. No doubt at all. It's all true passion. But this is going to be, I don't know, man. It's going to be a tough one for Pavel.
It is, for sure. But, you know, he can do it. Let's, like, look at the list more in detail. The Druid that he has, those Dark Arrow Koas, I've thought long and hard about how these can impact the matchup, and the 7 health coming down a turn earlier, giving him more options. You know, quite often for the Druid deck in the Druid Mirror on turn 6, it's kind of Moonglade Portal or it's Emperor or Bust, right? It's like very few plays to make, but
Pavel has that extra beef available to him in the mid game. He can tempo out a lot more effectively with the Dark Arakoas and put some pressure on, demand key removal spells used on the Arakoas, and then free up room for Malygos, Arcane Giants to dominate the board later on. He does also have Yogg-Saron in his Druid deck, which Amnesiac doesn't have available, which could be a huge swing for him as well. Obviously, his Tempo Mage can get the job done as well. Very, very minion heavy, but it looks like straight away he's going to go into the Druid mirror.
Yeah, and you know, we saw from the last game, Amnesiac just run out of juice and it just wasn't enough to finish the game. And you mentioned Yogg-Saron. It is one of that, you know, that sort of trick factor of, well, if all else fails, I will play this card, and sometimes it digs me out of a hole and we can, you know, potentially get a win or carry on for it. And Amnesiac doesn't have that choice. As you said, it's going to be the Druid Mirror. Both players with some form of ramp, Maya Keeper for Amnesiac, but Maya Keeper and now double Wild Growth and throw in an Innovate. Pavel's going to be feeling pretty good about this opening hand so far.
Just for clarity, we have one player with some kind of ramp, and we have another player with all the ramp. Literally all of it. Pavel here, definitely in an advantageous situation. So much ramp available to him. He's going to go all the way through to Maya Keeper. I think I like this line, just ramping up straight away with the Maya Keeper, has the Wild Growth to curve out with afterwards. So Amnesiac going to be right on the back foot from the get-go here.
Yeah, I think if there was one less of like no second Wild Growth, there's a chance to actually just ramp up into the Innovate, into Azure Drake, then into the Maya Keeper, and go a bit, you know, like forward and backwards in that sense. But with the second Wild Growth, you just keep hitting those all day, and you just simply put a minion on the board that Amnesiac has to deal with.
Even with the one Wild Growth this way, you know, it's the same thing essentially, except you get a 3-3 on turn one that just starts beating away. So he can still go into Drake again now next turn. So I like this line overall from Pavel, but Amnesiac here, he finds himself on the back foot. Still no ramp options available. He does now have a clean way to take care of the 3-3 at least and stop the beatdown of that coming. But Pavel still has gas to come here. Azure Drake curving into the Emperor won't have a huge impact in terms of discounts. But again, this is a theme throughout all of Pavel's decks. Druid, extra minions in the mid game. Tempo Mage, extra minions in the mid game. C'Thun Warrior, as far as Control Warrior goes, the most minion heavy build of that you can play. Pavel is a guy that just likes sticking idiots on the board and hitting you in the face with them.
Can't even argue with him on that one. It seems to be a pretty good strategy. It's got him extremely far. We are in the top 8 of the Hearthstone World Championships here at BlizzCon. And Pavel, I was literally about to say, when you get this like very ramp-heavy start, you can run dry a little bit and kind of just use all of your cards to ramp and then only have like one a thing to do per turn. Sometimes that's not enough if you have a dead draw of like a Wrath or something like that. It can be kind of awkward to work everything in. But Pavel's draws after that as Yordrake are looking pretty good. Now multiple six drop options. Dark Arakoa seems good to just slam down now. I think the reduction from the Emperor doesn't do too much at the moment.
Yeah, I do wonder what Emperor does for you in this position. Dark Arakoa has very obvious upside of just protecting your Azure Drake in this situation, which, just being a big idiot on the board that you can beat him up with.
Hey, so, Arakoa might be clever.
Sorry, I use idiot as a term of endearment. That's why I use it towards you so much.
Oh, yeah. This changes everything. Yeah. I guess we can be friends after all.
I favor the Dark Arakoa in this situation for that exact reason. He's already committed the Drake attack to face, so he's thinking about how to protect it at this point, and I think the Arakoa is my pick, but Pavel disagrees, so I'm interested into what his thought process here. What discounts is he particularly getting benefit out of it?
Yeah, I think the main thing I thought is looking at that Wild Growth, the reduction to one mana is nice, but he is a long way away from using that as a one mana cycler card. And does he really need to one mana ramp into anything when he has Arakoa, has Arcane Giant? I suppose it does make the Wild Growth the old, like, just play a spell, gain a mana, and reduce the Giant by a mana. So it's always playable next turn in combination with that Giant.
Amnesiac, again, not been getting the best of Raven Idols, it has to be said. Starfall is a reasonable pickup here. Power of the Wild as well as a usable tool. Actually, even Savagery, the fact he has the Feral Rage in his hand is at least a playable card, but he's not getting any of the super high value cards. You know, basically, he's not picking up additional copies of cards that you chose to put in your deck, which is what you are looking for most of the time.
Yeah, it's kind of tough as well. With the Feral Rage plus Hero Power, if he had one more mana, he could Savagery and clear the board, which would have been really nice, but not going to be quite enough. Power of the Wild looks like the option for him, though. I'm going to just bank that, save it a bit for later, I feel. Unless he wants to play it now and just put a 3-2 on the board, but just naturally just dies to everything anyway.
Yeah, he's obligated. His mana's too restricted this turn anyway. He's obligated to address the threats on board, so doesn't have room to fit in the Power of the Wild, but he's just trying to find a way to make a counter push later. Didn't think the other spells were going to be particularly useful, and the hits just keep on coming from Pavel in this situation. 5-7 on the board. He is just pushing the damage right now, and he has a couple more threats left over, although that Yogg is not a big deal now. Only a 3-spell Yogg, of course. Arcane Giant costing 8 with the 1 Emperor discount as well.
Yep. Yeah, he's just going to continue with the game plan of just punched him in the face. Amnesiac only on 17 now, Pavel sitting pretty at 30. And Amnesiac just doesn't have great stuff. This can happen sometimes where you have Arcane Giants that just haven't been reduced that much because you've drawn them quite early. The lack of spell ramp that Amnesiac's been missing this game is hurting him. And just not a lot he can really do. The Nourish is the chance, though. Nourish always a card where you take kind of like a rough turn most of the time
right.
to have a much better turn next time.
Yeah, the upside down card, I was about to say, I believe is Nourish. We saw just a peek of it as it came out of the deck. It flipped over for us there just in time, and that not going to be good enough to address this board state. And Pavel, just threatening lethal, has a swipe in hand for backup as well. Amnesiac gets offered the swipe from the Raven Idol, so he does have at least some removal options available to him, but not nearly enough to address this board state.
And that is going to be it.
The Pavel train keeps on rolling. Is Pavel going to be the comeback kid of opening week and BlizzCon? Can he really come back from a 0-3 deficit twice in a row?
Well, it definitely seems possible. These more minion-heavy decks from Pavel seem to be getting the work done, but he has still got to win 2 more, and we're going to find out if he continues his comeback right after this.
Hearthstone World Championship is sponsored in part by Intel, T-Mobile, NVIDIA, and Republic of Gamers.
Welcome back, everyone, to the Hearthstone World Championship here at BlizzCon. We have Pavel versus Amnesiac, and Pavel is slowly mounting his comeback. See if he can get this series and move on into the top 4 of this bracket. Can Pavel do it, Sol?
Of course he can. I mean, it's within the realm of possibility. He's still, you know, behind the play at this point, 2-3, but you know, both of these decks can get the job done. We've talked about this minion-heavy pattern throughout his deck, and he does still have Tempo Mage available. So if he just gets an aggressive minion-heavy draw and is able to push board presence, snowball his position, push through aggressive damage towards the Druid, and just rush them down, then we could go all the way to the last game, assuming that he does lead out with the Mage.
Yeah, and it is the Mage. Good work. And Amnesiac with his Druid, of course. And you know, you talk about the minion pressure and the fast pressure, something the Druid just doesn't deal with well. Outside of a big, like, for example, spell power swipe turn, which comes very late in the game most of the time, it's very difficult for the druid to swing the board to favor back on their end. And Pavel getting off to a pretty quick start himself with the Mana Worm, Cult Sorcerer, and Sorcerer Apprentice options.
Yeah, I mean, it used to be even more true. I mean, this matchup, when you replace the Malygos Druid with the old school double combo mid-range Druid, you know, Druid used to just play Wrath and Swipe, and that was it. That was their entire removal package. As time's gone on, they've been allowed to become more spell heavy because of initially Yogg-Saron and now Malygos and then Arcane Giants and all this stuff, you know, leveraging their ability to play spells. So they now have Feral Rages, they now have Living Roots, they now have a bunch of spell damage to pair with their removal
and
as well.
They've always had Moonfire, but now they use it.
Exactly, yeah. So their ability to fight for the board and play the minion removal game is actually stronger than it used to be, but you're absolutely right in the fact that Tempo Mage can do it while swinging the board a lot easier. You know, Amnesiac with the Druid is going to have to rely on a couple of very niche things to be able to do that. One is the Barrageddon that we see, and the other is the very, very cheap Arcane Giants.
Yeah, that's pretty much it. And you know, going to be Amnesiac's chance, as Pavel is drawing very well here, getting off to a relatively quick opening. Has a tough choice now. Could go for the Arcane Intellect on curve, but as we said, I feel like minion pressure is just way more important at this moment in time versus Amnesiac.
Yeah, he is just trying to load up the board. It's pretty much what his hand says at this point, is just to try and be aggressive and push through damage. And Cult Sorcerer, I think, unappreciated in terms of how aggressive it can be. You know, it almost like represents damage in the same way that pre-nerf Knife Juggler used to represent damage, where it's just a 3-2 that hits you pretty hard, and they also provide that plus one damage boost if you want to fire off some spells. So
yeah, and being the cheapest or one of the cheapest ways to combine with Arcane Blast is absolutely horrifying. You know, the 2-drop and a 1-mana spell just kills off a 5-drop, and then obviously, as you said, the 3-2 just hits you in the face. So does develop quite a lot of tempo, and we see some of the cheaper and more recent spells to the Druid being used. The Moonfire combined with the Azure Drake clearing that open. Pavel, not messing around. He locked the Frostbolt in before we even saw the card he drew.
And again, just minions, minions, minions. It's minions all the way down for Pavel in pretty much all of his decks, and the double Faceless Summoners here could be huge to try and push through. But Amnesiac, through that previous turn, managed to grip the board with Drake number one, Moonfire number two, and Drake number two come together. And now, this is not really a board state you want to develop a Faceless Summoner into, but Pavel has no option. And this Drake could just start to snowball the game now for Amnesiac.
Yeah, this is a spell damage swipe available. Even he could just use the Wrath and not have to trade in the Azure Drake. So this is looking really good.
Could he? He could also just choose to trade the Azure Drake in exchange for picking up a Raven Idol card here, which is potentially what he's going for. Moonfire number three! They've been doing work for him so far.
Keep him coming. No, I actually do like holding on to the Wrath here because it's a clean trade and the Azure Drake still has to be dealt with. And also you just hold on to a Wrath next turn. It's going to help you continue to just beat down these minions that you know are in Pavel's deck. The deck lists are open, so each player knows exactly what's in their opponent's deck, knows Pavel plays a minion heavy variant, and he is even more ready now with that second Wrath to help clear up some of this board.
Amnesiac just a little wince at that one, rolled back in his chair a little bit. The line of play he took where he made the little greedy line of going for the Raven Idol as well and using his Drake's health to trade, that opened him up to exactly that counter push from Pavel, Faceless Summoner number two and Arcane Blast. But based on Pavel's play so far, his lack of removal for a Drake would have told Amnesiac a lot of information about his hand. As I said, Amnesiac, one of the best hand readers in the entirety of Hearthstone. So the information that he gleaned from that play led him to be a little bit wasteful with his Drake.
Yep. Okay, question.
Yes.
Do you ever just go face because you have Fireball and Paul in hand? Because, there are some good trades that Geddon can pick up, but bear in mind, Geddon is going to do damage to Amnesiac as well. And with that Firelands Paul and even the Arcane Intellect, if he really wants to cycle further into the deck for more burn, this game could end very quickly.
In all seriousness, I think you do probably trade. You potentially make Rag a little too good by going face here. You also just have board dominance already. And as much as Firelands Portal is a burst card, it's also a great board dominance card. You can
use that card to get the signal of both kinds of play to you in this situation. But also, the Firelands Paul could just say to Pavel here that he can get away with going face, because even if in an emergency he needs to deal with the Baron Geddon next turn,
yeah,
he has that Firelands Paul to be able to do it. But all things considered, I like the trade. I don't think Pavel needs to be in a huge rush right now. He has the reach to get there eventually.
Yeah, and also this helps guard the Azir Drake, and the Azir Drake provides more damage for your spells as well. So the damage he missed out on this turn, he could probably gain at least some of that back through being able to burn heavily next turn. Ragnaros, yet again, coming down for Amnesiac. Let's see if he can do some work this time. And killing off the Drake, probably the best target there.
Absolutely the best target. Pavel now can potentially take a risk with the Flame Waker. He would need one shot on the Ragnaros, at least with the Fireball, to then be able to ping it off and continue to push damage to face. Firelands Portal and Trade is an alternative option as well. So Pavel, now, this is that moment when every competitive Hearthstone player goes through, is like, do I bet the series on a Flame Waker right now? Do I take the consistent line? Do I take the high risk, high reward line? This is something that you have to be able to assess on the fly to be one of the strongest Hearthstone players.
Yeah, I think looking at it overall, the Flame Waker is riskier, and next turn he can Flame Waker Arcane Intellect, see what comes out, and then Fireball, worst case, for a hell of a lot more damage. But he's going to go for it. This could change everything. A bit of shake of the head of the Pavel shows that they go to face. Ragnaros lives. He is not dying this turn, and this additional 8 damage to help clear this board or just push damage to face could change everything for Amnesiac here.
Still, Pavel kept his composure. He finished the turn by pinging off the rag anyway, which means he can ping it off next turn. It will run rampant for this one turn only, and obviously missing on the Ragnaros there is devastating for him. That could potentially, from his perspective, cost him so much damage in this situation. But the important thing is that he's still keeping calm, playing the cards correctly. Pinging off the Ragnaros is definitely a solid decision in that spot.
Yeah, and also regarding the ping, Amnesiac does not play Moonglade Portal.
Sure.
So one would have to come off a Raven Idol to be able to, you know, really punish just the ping there and heal right back up. And just in general, punish that turn from Pavel.
Yeah, but Amnesiac looks like he's potentially going to take a counter push here and try and force some of this damage through. He's actually going to gain the life with Feral Rage. Okay, so this runs the risk of leaving this Flame Waker up in play to potentially run roughshod over proceedings, but Rag behaves itself, takes care of the 2-4, and now this board state is looking
huge. I was just like, I complete two of those. Got my second one already.
Paul going to come down on the 3-3 here, has the ping on the 8-1 Rag. So he, rough opportunity, but yeah, Boogie Bay Bodyguard is a reasonable outcome in that spot, so still demands an answer from Amnesiac, but Maligos is a solid answer, and now Amnesiac could have turned the corner in this game. Pavel with the Tempo Mage, they do not deal with a 4-12. No hard removal played in the deck, but I was just about to say, this is a decision that Pavel has made. Amnesiac does not play this card in his Mage. This could be huge
here we
for
go.
Pavel.
Polymorph! To the Maligos. This is going to blow Pavel, Amnesiac, out of the water. Oh, look at it. Oh, my God.
The heartbreak on the face from Amnesiac. I think he actually pulled at his own hair a little bit there. He was so frustrated. And who
I don't
can blame
him.
That is an absolute backbreaker for Amnesiac. But he, just like Pavel on the previous turn, he needs to make sure now, take a deep breath, refocus, that's in the past now. Continue to play this game. You are not out of this game. You are not out of this series. Continue to play correctly from here, and you can still come out of this game on top.
Yeah, refreshing yourself after a moment like that is incredibly difficult, but incredibly important for these players. And Amnesiac has a hell of a lot of experience in tournament play. Let's see how he chooses to progress here. He can clear the board, does go for the Emperor. Can I get the reduction on the Windrunner? But to be honest, could have picked either at this point. Sylvanas is slightly more flexible based on the fact that Amnesiac isn't really going to have a big hand anytime soon to reduce.
Yeah, Sylvanas would be a little more flexible against, say, Firelands Portal number 2, because you can't just Firelands Portal or Sylvanas.
Oh my God!
And what did I say?
We should just choose what cards are there.
I mean, in the words of the late, great TJ Sanders, punished.
Oh, I mean, we would say Amnesiac needs to take a breath and recover from that polymorph. Can you recover from the second Babbling Book? Look how happy the book looks. I would want to cover that card on my screen if I was Amnesiac and just not want to look at it at all for the rest of this game.
That is a face that says, hey, buddy, I got you. Don't worry. But if Amnesiac needed cheering up, zero mana Arcane Giant could very well do the job, because he can definitely get a strong board presence here.
The frustration is, though, the Conjurer is that, you know, never feels like much of a threat because of the three health, normally very easy to remove. But the six attack makes this giant just very likely to die.
Yep.
There are so many spells left for Pavel that can just clear up that extra bit of damage. And Amnesiac knows Pavel's just sitting on three cards, fourth off the draw. So he's got plenty of juice to just carry on pushing and carry on with this pressure. And after those 2 bucks, I'm going to put 2 bucks in every mage deck I ever play and see if Pavel, and see if Pavel can teach me the way.
So Sylvanas is going to come down here, just going to try and trade one for one straight up with this Ethereal Conjurer, which I'm sure will happen. But Pavel's hand right now is just looking glorious in this situation. He can just trade and just play out the hand
just
that
do
he
what
has.
He wants.
Right. Flame Waker, Arcane Intellect, see what he draws. But the Water Elemental, it's hard to imagine a stronger play than that on this turn.
Oh,
can now follow it all up with Rag. Wow, I am never going to count Pavel out of a game and or series of Hearthstone in my life.
No, incredible that this has come to this point. Pavel looking great. Amnesiac does get the nourish, though.
Yep.
This is, again, as we said, just another opportunity for him to recover in this game that has gone disastrously wrong for him. He's managed to cycle into more cards.
That's huge.
He's got the Feral Rage. He can clear off the Flame Waker.
He can. He didn't have an answer for it up until that point, so now he is able to create a swing on the board. Feral Rage is down the Flame Waker. Zero mana Arcane Giant comes down.
So guess what is going to happen? The Arcane Giant is going to die like an insect.
Is it though?
I'm feeling it.
You're confident? Are you that confident in your read?
Yep.
All right.
Just because I've committed now, it's going to go face, I can tell.
It does clear out the minion. Amnesiac in a fantastic, or Amnesiac in a terrible spot. Pavel in a fantastic
definitely
spot.
Definitely not a
but
fantastic
honestly,
spot from Amnesiac.
That was a 50-50, of course, but the face damage there, not irrelevant as well. You know, Pavel still has burn left in his deck that he can dig through. Both Feral Rages were used at that point, so pushing the damage to face with the Rag there would have been fine as well. And Pavel, the comeback kid from Russia, what a performance.
Yeah, absolutely incredible. You see him just sit up in his chair there. He's like, okay, I got this. And we're going to find out if he can manage this ultimate comeback right after this. We are back with the decided game of Pavel versus Amnesiac here at BlizzCon. Absolutely incredible series so far. We didn't think Pavel could do it, but he has proved us wrong. He has continued to say that he can come back in a series, no matter how grim it looks.
Yeah, he ran the gauntlet in essentially his top 16 game at the end of opening week to make it through to this stage, coming back from 0-3 to win it 4-3. But this was just a different proposition. He was up against Amnesiac, the most dominant player from that opening week proceedings. He was up against Maligos Druid, one of the most dominant decks we've seen in the meta over the last couple of months. So the deck just seemed to be so heavily stacked against him, but Pavel doesn't care what the odds are. He's going to find his way through regardless, and we have come all the way full circle back to Maligos Rogue against Maligos Druid. It's going to be nuts.
It is, and these players, this is single elimination. The loser is out. The winner moves on to the semi-finals of the World Championship. Everything on the line for these players. This is going to be the last game for one of these guys. The winner will move on. And Amnesiac now has a hell of a lot of ramp in his opening, but nothing quite to ramp into until the Maya Keeper came out.
That feeling when you can play your entire hand on turn one.
Yeah, on paper it sounds cool. A lot of the time it doesn't work out very well.
Druid of the Flame available here. I love this decision from Amnesiac. He didn't really get rewarded for it, although the Forbidden Ancient is kind of cute. Basically, looking at his hand...
Just drop a 7/7.
Right, looking at his hand, he has a million mana available, but nothing to spend it on. So he went for a minion to try and find something to spend all the mana on. Didn't get a huge threat, but Forbidden Ancient, I guess, fulfills that role. Picks up the Drake as well, no. So now his hand is looking a lot more well-rounded.
Yeah, especially now he can just hero power in, use the Moonfire if he wants to feel extremely defensive, and then go for an Innovate into the Azure Drake next turn. But we will see. It's going to be at least a hero power for now. Just get rid of that spell power. Thanos is going to cycle, but never want to leave a spell power minion on the board if you can help it.
Yeah, I think Pavel just gave a little nod there and said, okay, no Wild Growth. We can work with this, but I don't think he quite knows what's coming over the next few turns. There's no Wild Growth, but there is a lot of mana acceleration to come here, and Amnesiac is now drawing into some of those huge threats that he needs to be able to spend all this mana that he has available to him.
Yeah. Wouldn't even mind... Okay, he's going to go for the Maya Keeper. If he went out with the Drake, he could even just Moonfire down the 1-1 just to make it even more safe and require an even firm answer from Pavel. But he's going to take it slow and wants to build into the big turns later. So bear in mind, Pavel is playing the Maligos version of the Rogue and not the Questy Adventure one that can start to stack up a hell of a lot of damage based on Cold Bloods and Stealth minions. Maligos Rogue takes a while to get cooking.
Yeah, much harder for this deck to just push through on tempo. They don't have that option to go for the Cold Blood Conceal Gambit, for example, that you see a lot of rogues doing in awkward situations, because those cards just aren't available to them in their deck. They do have to kind of push through to their eventual win condition more consistently. It's a more linear game plan a lot of the time, just with the quality mid-range minions that they have available to them backing that up. So Pavel knows he's not going to get out of this game quickly, and Amnesiac will know that as well, which will give him solace because he will still feel like he's going to have time to play through all these power cards in his hand.
Yeah, and if it's something you want as the Druid player in general, it's just more time. A lot of the time, you actually just draw most of your deck and end the game through that. Both players pretty much looking for that game plan overall, and there's Ragnaros in Amnesiac's hand. That guy has a lot to answer for. He's joining the Heroes of the Storm squad as one of the new characters, and he thinks he's everything now, being involved in almost every game. And okay, that is a huge backstab, and now I just like the coin shiv.
I mean,
shiv him in the face.
It's not as readily apparent as it seems, because that coin is a phenomenal card in Pavel's hand right now. He has an Auctioneer and a Van Cleef that both want to use that coin. It would be a very disciplined move to hold this back, but I think this is right. I think Pavel has actually seen the line here. I commend his patience in this situation. I think that coin is more useful in his hand than just 6 damage to face.
I would have still liked to see the shift to face.
I know that you like hitting people in the face, Alex, but sometimes...
Whoa, in Hearthstone, come on.
Yeah, okay, sure.
Don't just tell everyone I like punching people in the face. That's not true.
To clarify, Alexander Bagley has 0 assault convictions.
Thanks. But there is Ragnaros. He's going to need to make an impact. He's been one of the most impactful cards in this series, at least. He's going to have to do some work now as Amnesiac going to great lengths to push forward in. He does have the backup plans of the Sylvanas, has the Fandral into Feral Rage as well. Rag is not playing nice this time and just kills off the 1-1. Nothing like what Amnesiac would have wanted from that turn.
Nope, but no super clean answer for Pavel. And by super clean, I just mean sap, essentially, because, you know, sapping Rag doesn't feel great sometimes if you can't really net huge tempo backing it up. But when it's been innovated out, sap is, of course, the answer that you're looking for. No such luck right now. But Pavel is just picking up damage in this situation, so he might just decide that it's time to flick the switch here and just race this with minions, although the Eviscerate does give him the Ragnaros answer that he needs as well.
Yeah, it's a yeah. It looks like he might actually go for the face tank. I like this.
Face tank coin, Edwin.
Yeah, I like it. I was gonna say there is the option to coin Shiv to do it, but then you develop no minions and you're just gonna basically hand Amnesiac a tough free turn to some extent. So I like this one. Van Cleef is gonna come down as an 8/8, and a lot of the time there's only really Mulch that is an answer, unless you can play Sylvanas.
And I've spoken multiple times this series about what a great hand reader Amnesiac is, but you do not need to be a great hand reader to put Pavel on no sap right now, based on that turn that you saw from Pavel coming out. So the Sylvanas almost guaranteed to get his work done here.
Gadget Zan, prep, sap. I can see it now.
You're a dreamer, Alex.
I mean, it might just be the line he has to go for here.
I mean, you can actually double your draws by Sinister Striking
first, and then you can
hit sap off this draw or off the draw from the preparation. That appears to be what Pavel is going for here. If he doesn't get it,
looks like he gets it! Called it! The sap, and Amnesiac is not happy, and understandably so.
But
just
again,
when he needed it.
Remember, and I say this with the greatest of love, you would not have got that sap with the play that first came into your mind.
Oh, yeah, of course.
You had to stop and think about it, realize that playing the Sinister Strike doubled your outs, and this is exactly what I've been talking about from Pavel the whole time. He considered his options that turn. He found the stronger line. He's put himself in a potential game-winning, match-winning, World Championship semi-finals position because of it.
Yeah, this is huge. The temptation for a less experienced player to say, well, of course I save Sinister Strike for Maligos. It's how I win the game. It's all my damage. Very, very tempting indeed. But Pavel knows better and may win this game because of it. And winning this game, as you said, winning this series and moving on. This is going to be almost an impossible task for Amnesiac at this point. That sap was simply crippling.
Chill Wind Yeti in 2016. This 4-5 on the board might just end up sealing the game for him. That Forbidden Ancient that he picked up to try and spend a huge amount of mana on does end up coming down as a 5-5 to contest. Pavel is looking at 6 damage right now. He's going to go Auctioneer here. Second sap going to come out. He's just going to dig. Yeah. Backstab picked up. He's just going for minion presence right now.
And look at this for next turn. He has Shiv, Fan of Knives for guaranteed card draw. Regardless of whether the Auctioneer lives, Amnesiac has to clear this board. Swipe is going to help.
It just isn't.
This is not enough.
It just isn't.
No,
he gets himself to 6. I cannot believe my eyes. At one point I said Young Savage was already written on the trophy, but Pavel had other ideas. Shiv to the face, dagger to the face from 0-3 to 4-3.
He's doing it again.
Twice in the course of 1 week, Pavel takes up the win for EU. I cannot believe what we're seeing.
No, meaning absolutely incredible series. Amnesiac off to a fantastic start, but Pavel did not want to go down easily. And from, as you said, 0-3 again, all the way back up to 4-3. He does move on, and he will be facing